Welcome to the Pacific Research Institute's Next Round podcast. I'm Rowena Ichon, COO, and with me, as always, is Tim Anaya, Vice President of Marketing and Communications. How are you, Tim?
I am great. How are you?
Fine, thank you. Well, it's that time of the legislative year when the governor signs or vetoes bills passed in the California Assembly and Senate. So, Tim, you've been following a lot of these bills. One bill that I was kind of annoyed by is this bill, AB 460, by Rebecca Bauer-Kahn, and it increases the fines 20-fold or up to $10,000 a day plus $2,500 for every acre foot of water that is used. Now, this bill, the history of this bill is that under, of course, a worse summer months of the drought a few years back, some California farmers and ranchers facing an existential moment when it came to their crops and animals overpumped the water they were allowed. So now the government is coming after farmers and ranchers for a kingly sum just when at some point where their livelihoods will be at stake. So, you know, the fault, of course, is in the government for not ever having built the infrastructure to mitigate the water problems we've had in the state. There are droughts. It's part of the California arid climate. We are going to have droughts. And they've really never done anything about it. So I shake my head at this very punishing bill for our farmers and our ranchers.
And you're exactly right, Ro. I mean, I wish they would put the same effort into clearing up the bureaucracy to build much needed above ground water storage. You know, we saw about a week ago the Sites Reservoir project in the North State, which is the most, quote, shovel ready project. They have the money. Newsom's all behind it. You know, there's a lot of muscle behind it. And what happened when it was just about ready to go to get the final approval? CEQA. And so there is more bureaucracy they now have to go through in order to get a final approval. And surprise, surprise on that, because we wrote about those things in our CEQA gauntlet project. But yes, we're once again kind of going after farmers, and we're not doing what we should be doing, which is creating more water storage and securing more water, not only for us to drink, but also to grow the crops we need to eat and to feed the world. Another interesting package of bills that the governor has been acting on are kind of issues related to tech, and there's a whole bunch of them. And, you know, if you listened to our podcast last week with Bartlett Cleland, we talked about some of these things. So one of the bills that was signed was SB 976, and that requires parental consent before minors can view so-called algorithmic social media feeds that are curated for individuals rather than, you know, just a simple chronological feed of people's posts. And, you know, Bartlett made the case, of course, well, shouldn't parents be the one ultimately policing their children's online traffic? You know, should the government really be doing this? So that is an interesting piece. But then on the flip side, you know, we talked last week a lot about AI, both at the federal level and at the state level. And the governor, interestingly, vetoed SB 1220, where his worlds collided, union priorities and the tech world's priorities. And SB 1220 would have barred government agencies from using AI in their call centers. You know, if you have to call a state agency for help, often the calls are answered by call centers. And the bill would have said you could not use AI if the technology replaced employees. Well, you know, Newsom vetoed that bill. But, you know, it's not surprising when you think about kind of across the board and AI and in technology, when you have things like the $20 restaurant minimum wage, for example. Well, don't be surprised if companies are going to go to robotics and increasing automation, and the same in state government and the same in anywhere in the private sector. Well, when the costs of doing business are more expensive, of course you're going to use something that's more efficient. And technology, you know, we don't need to fear disruption. The history of the U.S. economy is that of disruption. Disruption is hard, but it always leads to better things. And so, you know, here's a good one that Newsom, the broken clock was right twice that day with Newsom vetoing that bill. But it'll be interesting to watch those and see how those issues develop, because we'll inevitably be debating these AI bills next session as well.
And Newsom also signed SB 1053, and that's the bill that ends plastic bags by most California checkout aisles. That's because apparently those thicker plastic bags that were encouraged to be reused are apparently still a nuisance to the legislature. So listeners, you still have to pay for your brown paper bag, and I know 10 cents isn't much, but who knows, over time it could be a quarter. And correct me if I'm wrong, Tim, but wasn't the whole point of moving to plastics was to save the trees. So I don't know what people are going to do. I bet what they'll do is start saving their Amazon boxes to load up their groceries. Or better, order everything and have it delivered to your door so you don't even have to navigate the bag issue. So what do you
Yes,
think?
I do often. I do online delivery of my groceries. You can do it from your favorite stores and it's great. But you're exactly right. This is the result of what the legislature wanted. They ordered this when they passed the first plastic bag ban. And so now all of a sudden we're turning on a dime again. And by the way, you're exactly right. The plastic bag ban was the result of, yeah, they didn't want to have paper bags. This is not going to be the last of this, but it's once again the legislature legislating away convenience. And, it's a problem. It really hasn't been demonstrated that it's the problem that the proponents say it is, but it's great TV. It's great, it's a great image on TV. Look at me, I fought the plastic bags. But in the end, it's going to be more inconvenient and more expensive for the consumer. So, one last bill that was very interesting, we've had a lot of back and forth, a lot of high profile coverage of two issues. Related to the undocumented. So remember, there was that big hullabaloo over the bill that would give a down payment assistance program to the undocumented. Well, Newsom vetoed that bill. And then there was the second bill, which would say that students who are undocumented, and remember, students who are undocumented can attend state schools in California. There was a bill that would have allowed campus jobs to be filled by undocumented students. And Newsom vetoed that bill. And he said that, of course, educational opportunity is important for immigrants and it's important for the economy. But he said there are a lot of legal risks with that bill. And it's critical that the courts address this issue and the kind of legal theory behind it before the state moves forward. And of course, all the, kind of his left-wing base are very upset by the whole thing. And, the author of the bill said, Assemblyman David Alvarez said, federal governments failed Dreamers and they've failed on immigration reform. And, all of that is, of course, true. But, Newsom is right. You don't want to open the state up to millions and millions of dollars in lawyers' fees and endless litigation. You got to sort these things out. And unfortunately, on immigration, even though a state like California may want to go further, these really are issues that need to be decided at the federal level, their failure to do anything productive on the issue notwithstanding.
And I also, Tim, think that it's a tough situation. A lot of my friends back in the day were part of these school work programs to help support themselves. They didn't have families, parents who could shoulder their tuition bill, and they worked on these jobs to help support themselves through school. And I think it's an important program for these kids. And I'm just wondering, with a high cost of tuition these days, it'll crowd out citizens from having these jobs. So it's not a good look, in my opinion.
Exactly. And you feel for the kids going through it and their immigration status notwithstanding, nearly all of them, they're doing it because they want a chance at the American dream and they want to get a good education and get ahead in life. But government and basically the federal government has failed them and they've failed taxpayers as well.
So I love these two next guests. That's because they're Tim and I and our own Carrie Jackson. So many of our listeners know that Tim and I is our Vice President of Marketing and Communications, and Carrie Jackson is our senior fellow in California Reform Studies. So they have joined forces to author this wonderful book called The California Left Coast Survivor's Guide. And it's a handbook to help those of us, frankly, survive California. So it's a fun read. It's like reading one of those old scouting manuals. So you'll have topics like how to prevent a wildfire or what to bring to California when you're on vacation, like a lot of plastic. Of course, you got to remember to bring suitcases of money because, yep, everything is super expensive here in the state. So, Tim, any words about your book how you felt about writing it?
Well, it's interesting, certainly, to have something come out under your name. Certainly, edited a lot of books since coming to PRI, but never thought I would actually write one. But I guess my only message for our great listeners here is it's available now at your favorite online bookseller. So go buy a copy today. We're at Amazon and all your favorite places. And I think you have to, it's one of those books, it will be available as an e-format. I think seeing the hard copy, this is a book you want to get a hard copy of.
Thanks everyone for listening, and here's our own Timanaya and Carrie Jackson. We're thrilled to have you both on Next Round to talk about your terrific new book. First, let's start with a physical look of the book. When readers pick up a copy, they'll think they are looking at one of the old Boy Scout or Girl Scout manuals. What was the thinking behind the book and the survival guide theme?
Well, to our listeners, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Ro's actually being a little modest because Ro came up with the idea for the survival guide,
Thank you, Tim.
which really is a brilliant way to look at California. You know, PRI has had a front row seat to all of the really bad policy ideas that have been coming from California over the past 45 years. And so, you know, even though we know our ideas are right and we're optimistic about being able to change things, you know, we kind of look at it as we're here in the policy wilderness on the left coast. And so if you think about the old Boy Scout guides and the Girl Scout guides about surviving the wilderness, it really is a great analogy for, you know, trying to not only survive in a policy wilderness if these ideas come to your town or if you are a visitor and come to California, have to endure some of our crazy laws, but B, these are ideas that are spreading like wildfires across the country, especially with Kamala Harris now running for president. And so the theme of having a survivor's guide really lends itself to, in a user-friendly and entertaining, in many ways, way, telling the story of these ideas, giving people, you know, little nuggets and little funny analogies. And there's lots of nice pictures and drawings in it. It's really a beautiful book, but it really gives you what you need to know about these ideas that are not only coming to Washington, but are coming to city halls and state capitals around the country. So if you pick up a copy of our book and you live across the country, you're going to get what you need to know about these bad ideas, our analysis of these ideas, and kind of the nuggets you need to know to hopefully stop these ideas. And as we say in our subtitle, help your state or community avoid making a wrong left turn.
I'll just quickly add to that. When I found out about the theme, as a writer, first I thought it was very brilliant, but as a writer, I was jealous. You know, gosh, why didn't I think of that? Why didn't I think of that 2 years ago or 2 months ago? So yeah, it caused a little bit of envy on my part. So I was very happy to be able to follow up, at least if it wasn't my idea, to follow up on the other end of it, to put some flesh on that, on the idea.
Much of the book centers on what Governor Gavin Newsom calls the California way, and which is now inspiring Kamala Harris as she seeks a presidency. If our friends who live in Georgia or Pennsylvania pick up a copy of your book, what are a couple of bad ideas from California that are already spreading like wildfire across the Sierra Nevadas?
I'm going to start with Assembly Bill 5, which was passed, well, it's been more than a few years ago now, almost a half decade ago, if my memory serves. And this is, I was hit particularly hard by this, but it essentially outlaws, and I use that word guardedly, but it outlaws independent contracting or independent contract work or gig work, freelance work, any way you want to put it, in California. And there have since been, of course, some exemptions, but it was not asked for. Nope, there was no groundswell. There was no, we've got to have this law passed. We've got to, people like their independent contract and their gig arrangements. But unfortunately, this has started to spread across the country, and it's very frightening. It's a miserable law. It was probably the most hated law in the 27 years I have lived in California. I can't remember anybody hating the law this much. It has destroyed livelihoods. It has hurt people's ability to put money on the table to add to their weekly, monthly, and yearly income. And unfortunately, as I said, it spread to other states. And the administration, the Biden-Harris administration, has wanted to pass something called the PRO Act at the federal level, which is more encompassing, but it still has a provision that, you know, that does away with the independent contracting. It hasn't passed yet. It's had difficulty, thank goodness, in Congress. But if Harris is elected, she will, I'm sure, continue to try to follow this out. And nobody says, hey, let's see how this hurts people, how it affects the average person. They don't care. And this word, I have used this word, and I know Tim has used this word to describe. It's a cruel law. There's no reason it should ever exist. And then another thing I would look at is the EV mandate in California, which has also inspired other EV mandates, electrical vehicle mandates across the country. Now, again, they're not saying you have to have an electrical vehicle. They're structuring it as such that that's the only type of vehicle that will be available, when they're saying you can't have a gas-powered or diesel-powered automobile. Harris has retreated somewhat or backpedaled away from support for an EV mandate. She's simply trying to align herself as a more centrist candidate. And, you know, it would be a shock if on 2 days or the day after, or the afternoon of inauguration, if she was elected, if she didn't go back on that right away. There are a lot of problems with an EV mandate, not the least of which, especially in a state like California is trying to go to an all renewables grid. You're going to cause problems. You're going to drain the grid. You're going to demand more electricity that's available. And we know when that happens, then you really have trouble with, you know, blackouts. Nobody wants to live through that. We live in the first world. We shouldn't be having blackouts all the time. But that's the future that this is, that, you know, an EV mandate promises.
For me, kind of continuing on the cruel theme, two things that I think people would be surprised to learn about are there's a proposal from the South Coast Air Quality Management District that was enacted within the last couple of years that would ban commercial gas ovens. And these are the ovens that, commercial kitchens would use to produce baked goods for restaurants and stores. Now, you might think, oh, well, we need to do that for climate change. Well, there really isn't an acceptable electric alternative on the market. And where there are, they're very, very expensive. But what the staff analysis says of that proposal is 3,200 people are going to lose their jobs because of that, and largely minority workers who work in those commercial kitchens. The other one would ban commercial gas-powered lawn equipment. And, you know, again, you might think, well, there's a lot of electrics on the market, but not in the commercial sphere. And what that proposal would do, that's, again, a hit on entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is the key to climbing the economic ladder. And a lot of small entrepreneurs have landscaping and lawn care businesses. And in particular, a lot of minority entrepreneurs have landscaping and lawn care businesses. And so you're really striking at the heart of entrepreneurship in California when you have mandates like these, where, once again, it would be prohibitively expensive and, you know, may make it you unable to do your business. Then there's the absurd. And for me, it's the proposal that was enacted a few years ago to ban the little plastic shampoo bottles in hotel rooms. Now, there's not a scourge of those. There was never a problem that anyone communicated. It was just one state legislator had this dumb idea and wanted to, you know, get some attention in the news media. And that's all it takes to change a law in California. You know, all of us at home, we have dumb ideas all the time, but we don't have the ability to make state law. Unfortunately, in California, our state legislators have a lot of dumb ideas and they have the ability to change state laws. So I think those are the kinds of things that people would be surprised to learn about. And those are the things, especially the little plastic shampoo bottle ban. You know, let Hyatt and Marriott decide if they want to change it. That's their business. They can evaluate, you know, the products they're offering, the costs, you know, what's more efficient and cost effective for their business and for their customers. We don't need state legislators to be doing that. But those dumb ideas, I can't tell you the number of bills that are enacted where we say, well, we started it in California, so let's do it here. Well, I hope if you read our book, you'll learn pretty quickly. No, we shouldn't.
The subtitle of your book is A Pacific Research Institute Handbook to Help the Rest of America Avoid Making a Wrong Left Turn. Of course, being free market capitalist, I'm sure that you'd be selling a lot of books in our home state in addition to across the country. What can readers who are living in the free market wilderness that is California learn from reading your book, and what might they be surprised to learn from the book?
I don't think they're going to be surprised by the number of businesses that have been leaving California now for quite some time, for more than 10 years, going back really in close 20 years of this exodus of flight of business. I think they may be somewhat surprised by some of the details that are involved in has made California hostile to business and commerce. And when we have the regulatory and tax regime is so burdensome that businesses are saying we can't operate that. We can't operate under these circumstances. And in some cases, they're closing too. But I mean, we looked at now that we have a $20 an hour minimum wage for fast food workers, and now I just see where some Shake Shacks are closing in California. And we've seen this before, but now the news is Shake Shacks are closing because they just can't afford to pay those kind of wages and continue to make money. And the businesses aren't charities, although I sometimes feel like 90% of policymakers think they are, that they can endure any kind of levy, any kind of tax in their direction. But it's not just small businesses or even medium-sized businesses, large businesses, headquarters. They're just moving. They're leaving. They're saying we're done. We can't operate under those conditions. But then we also have residents leaving too. And this is something of a newer trend. People have always left California, but up until a few years ago, more people had come in any given year than had left. Now we're having a net loss of people, in fact, for the first time in the state's history. So again, we have issues with taxes, the tax burden, the income tax burden is monstrous in California compared to a lot of other states, some of which have no state income tax. The cost of living is high. That's a product of poor public policy that's been going on for decades now. So people might want to, they might be a little surprised to find out some of the details, some of the things that are behind the exodus, the flight of people and businesses from California.
I think for me, because we've had a decline in kind of traditional media covering the ins and outs of the state capital every day, I think there are a lot of laws that people just aren't aware of. And it's often too late when these dumb ideas rear their ugly head in people's lives. I always find myself saying, well, gee, when do we pass that law? I don't remember weighing in on that or voting on that. So I think this book is a good one, just to have a handbook to know what are the crazy things I didn't even know about that may be coming down the pipeline that I'm going to have to live with and deal with in my personal life, in my business. And maybe it'll inspire people to advocate for grassroots reforms to these laws or repealing of some of these laws. So I think as a, just as a resource guide, I think Californians would enjoy the book. And also too, I think there'll be a lot of people nodding their heads as they read through some of the things and saying, yep, we've had to deal with that. Yep, we've had to deal with that.
Thumbing through the book, readers will see that it's a very visually appealing book and lots of drawings through the whole book. One of the most striking features are the front and back inside covers. There's a version of the famous poop map on the front side of the cover and a beautiful image of a city on the back inside cover. Share the story of these maps with our listeners.
We were all certainly amused by the policy entrepreneur who a few years back just got on Google and made a Google map in San Francisco of all of the city crews, the little incidents where they had to go and clean up poop on the sidewalk. They actually log every one. And so, kind of drew national attention and, showed just how out of control things had come in San Francisco. So we thought we want to have our own version of that in our book, but we want it to be more than that. So we actually came up with two maps, and the maps are representations. They're not obviously, real. But the in the front inside cover, you see kind of all the bad things of California. So you see poop on the street, you see graffiti, you see crime, you see no vacancy signs, you see businesses closed. Every time I look at it, actually, I find something else that I didn't see the first time. So that's in the front cover of kind of how bad things have gone symbolically in California. But then again, given that we're not negative Nellies, we want to have inspire the kind of change and inspire the free market ideas that we know are the best for California and the country. On the back inside cover, we have what it should be, what it could be if free market ideas carried the day in California. So you see beautiful community and parks and low housing costs and plenty of available housing and safe streets and thriving businesses. So I think visually it shows, sadly, what we're all going through, but then hopefully what it could be if we did things the right way.
I'll just add that I think Dana did a great job. Her ability to take images and make formulate strong messages from images. In this case, they're fun. So just I think she did a great job with it, and I'm very appreciative of her work.
Yes, I agree. Dana Beagle is our graphic designer and our creative director here at PRI, and she puts out these beautiful books for us and studies and briefs, and we love her work. And they really, well, a picture is worth a thousand words, and she really helps convince or help, is a great addition to our movement. So naturally, your book has received a lot more attention with a nomination of our most famous California political right now, Kamala Harris. Readers can get a good idea of what a Harris presidency might be from reading our book and looking at some of the bad policies from California that are already influencing policy in the Biden-Harris administration. So paint the picture for our readers. How does the California Way offer a preview of a potential Harris administration?
Well, three things come to me right away, and I think we could look for, and this may be seem hard to believe it, but an ever-expanding or even greater expanding regulatory framework at the Washington level, at the federal level, and the never-ending and a growing thirst for tax dollars, for revenue. I mean, she's already signaled that. It's the unrealized capital gains tax. Then you can also have a government that's more interested in growing itself. It's gaining power than performing basic duties. It doesn't want to limit itself to any kind of constitutional limits. There's a lot of mismanagement. I think we see more of that. Competence, appointing people who can't do the job, they're not competent to do the job. And the other thing that comes to me right offhand, busybody public officials. California has a lot of folks up in Sacramento who want to prescribe the right way for all of us, the rest of us, to live. And I bring back the EV mandates for one of those, but that's just one of many. So I think you're going to see a lot more of that at the federal level under a Harris administration.
So Governor Newsom recently said that people would be surprised to learn that they pay more for energy in states like Texas and Florida than they do in California. Of course, as PRI has shown in our research, that line is demonstrably false. Newsom's green mandates are a key theme in your book. So talk about how the California Way drives up people's energy costs to unacceptably high levels.
Power out here, electrical power and gasoline too, but I was just going to look at, the power that comes into your house. It has been higher than average, in fact, some of the highest rates in the entire country for some time. We have a lot of mandates, green energy mandates, and that's even before talking about the 2045 deadline for the grid to be zero emission. Essentially, that's just going to be solar and wind. There's really nothing else. There are a few other things that are going to be acceptable under the zero emission definition, but they're going to contribute such a small part to the portfolio, the energy portfolio. They might as well not even exist. As they're phasing out conventional natural gas for the most part, and the remainder of the nuclear, we're going to have even higher costs because they're building out. That doesn't come at, they say it's an investment. Well, that doesn't come at no cost. It's the infrastructure, and as well as connecting these solar farms and wind farms to the grid. Somebody's got to pay for that. Well, where's that going to come from? We also look at, it's not just residents paying higher prices, but businesses pay higher prices, and this hurts them. This hurts their bottom line, their ability to expand, their abilities to hire. I think there's in Sacramento, there's inability to really understand what their policies are doing.
And to add to Carrie's point, it's also about reliability. How do you keep the lights on a cloudy day in California when you're relying on solar power? Well, that's what natural gas does. If natural gas goes away, well, naturally, how are we going to make up that demand? And oh, by the way, when we have our 100% electric car mandate in place in 2045, as a great study by Carrie and by our Wayne Weingarten showed, we're going to be 21% short of the power we need every day just to meet the regular demand on the grid. And that doesn't even take into account, the push for all electric HVAC and get water heaters and stoves and such. The other thing I would add to that is on gas and on the price of driving, which of course is more expensive in California. Now, Newsom and the Democrats have tried to go around and they've had this kick on, we're going after, quote, oil company price gouging, and they've had all these hearings and investigations into it. Well, we could have saved all that money because they just need to look in the mirror, because it's government policy that's price gouging Californians on every time they fill up their car. Now, this fluctuates a little bit, but the latest numbers show that Californians pay another $1.41 per gallon every time they fill up, thanks to government taxes, fees, and the regulatory costs of gas and oil production in California. Then, of course, in California, there's this movement that's been catching on and that Carrie has written about, where cities are putting planning dictates in place that would essentially outlaw the construction of new gas stations. So even if you need gas, and even if you can afford the ridiculous prices of gas in California, you might not be able to find a gas station nearby in the not too distant future.
So a lot's been made of Kamala Harris's first policy proposal, which is going after the supposed price gouging by grocery stores. But reading your book, you could really make the case that high grocery prices are really the result of the types of policies in the California way. So how so?
That's exactly right. So, there are the inflationary policies of the Biden-Harris administration that came from, all that Inflation Reduction Act spending that pushed us into the inflation that we saw over the last couple of years. That's one thing. But if you think about it, the California way adds to it in so many other ways. So take retail theft, for example. We had Keith Knopf, who's the president and CEO of the Raley's Grocery Store Company, speak at a PRI event a couple of years ago. And he said that their company alone, which has about 235 or so stores over six or seven states, they lose $60 million a year in California just for retail theft. And he says, that's money for nothing. That's money we can't, that he, they can't use to give their employees raises. And it certainly is money they can't use to lower costs. So there's that. Think about policies like Prop 12, the new requirements on pork production and egg production. Keith Knopf says, Raley's now, because you can't raise prices like crazy on everything, eggs have become a loss leader for them. They lose a dollar on every carton of eggs they sell. And pork loin, as we've seen in the recent data, is 41% higher in California after the passage of Prop 12. And thanks to the Supreme Court ruling on the case involving Prop 12, Prop 12, the policy, is basically impacting other states. So other states are already having to follow these crazy laws for pork production. And then you go down the line of, minimum wage laws, those hero pay mandates that were put on during the pandemic, forcing higher minimum wage on grocery store workers during the pandemic, which resulted in store closures. You have issues with ag policy, right? Because we haven't built new above ground water storage, it's harder for farmers to have the water they need to grow the crops to meet the demand. So if crops are scarcer and less available, that means, of course, they're costing more. Then you have all the issues with, the farm labor regulations that add to cost of food production. So all of that down the line, and many more, the green mandates, solar requirements, all the building requirements, the commercial gas oven bans, all of those things, they all add to the cost of doing business, and they all impact the price you pay at the grocery store.
Oh, that's far too impressive, Tim, for me to even try to add anything to that. That was one breath.
As we close, potential readers of the California Left Coast Survivor's Guide may go through the book and conclude that it's just a rant about all of California's problems. But you both wrote the book to inspire readers and give them the tools to chart a different policy course in their communities. So what do you hope readers in California and in other states ultimately take away from reading your terrific new book?
Get the government out of the private sector as much as possible, and where the government does get involved in the private sector, tread as lightly as possible. Leave commercial endeavors alone. Let people freely engage in voluntary agreements or voluntary commerce. Let them associate without any kind of regulations, any kind of restrictions. And look, rather than look at what California is doing, and California has for so long wanted to say, this is the way we do it, and this is the way you need to do it. Going all the way back to automobile emissions. California has a special privilege, I'm going to call it a privilege, to have stricter emission laws on automobiles than the other 49 states. So rather than look to California, look at the other states and see ones that are successful, where people are moving, where people are earning higher income, where businesses are saying, this is where we want to be because the opportunity is greater. We're not put in a box and suffocated. Of course, the ones that are going to come to mind are Texas, Tennessee, Florida. But even Arizona and Nevada, I think, are also some of the things they're doing in these states can be models for, how to do it, as opposed to California's how not to do it.
Well, what I would say is, and one of the things that we note in the book is that, obviously through humor, you can't help but laugh about some of these wild ideas that we're living under in our once golden state. One of the things I would say is, we hope we've given you a great resource to not only learn about these ideas before they gain too much of a head of steam in your state, but as we note in the index of the book, there's a companion website to the book, which is at leftcoastsurvivorsguide.com. And we have laid out there even more of PRI's great studies and resources. So you can get even more information on any of these ideas. And it's not just, more data and analysis of why the ideas we talk about here are bad, but it's also a lot of here's what we should be doing. Here are positive ideas that we should be enacting that can help us achieve these goals. I think on a lot of these policies, we would share the same goal with the people who are putting forward these big government proposals. We just have a different way that we go about it. And we know that free market solutions and market-based ideas are the way forward. And so I hope that they take away that, A, these ideas are absurd. You're not wrong. They are absurd. We just have a, kind of out to lunch legislature that rushes to adopt these things. But B, that you can fight these things, that there are people who agree as we do and think as we do, and that hopefully we give you the ideas here to fight these. Because when you fight with the facts, when you fight with, in many cases, the dollar amounts, take reparations. We deal with the reparations push here in California. But one of the things, if you listen to the proponents of reparations talk, they never talk about how much it costs. Well, we at PRI, when we talk about reparations, and as you see in the chapter in the book, which is called The Price is Wrong, we talk about the cost, which is $2.8 trillion over 30 years. So, having some of these figures really can put you in the driver's seat to not only stop these bad ideas, but achieve the free market vision and the free market future that we all want to see.
So, Tim, we ask these questions of all of our guests. So now it's our turn. We call our podcast Next Round because of PRI's proximity to wine country and our love of discussing public policy over a great glass of California wine. So what wine, beer, cocktail, or other beverage are you both enjoying these days to celebrate the publication of your terrific new book?
I'm not going to look at just one single wine I'm enjoying. I'm going to plug a store called Grocery Outlet that I discovered. One opened not too far from me. Wow, I guess now about 5 years ago. And It just allows you to sample a lot of different and good wines, and sometimes they cost only $5, $6, $7 each, and you may pay $15, $20, $30, sometimes more for this wine at other shops. They get overstocked, and you think, well, maybe I have to be careful. Maybe this wine was sitting in a hot warehouse somewhere for several years and it's burned and it's no good. But every one exception, every wine I've ever bought from Grocery Outlet has been quite enjoyable. None of it has been ruined or burned, and this has allowed me to go across. Instead of buying $2 Chuck every time, I can sample a lot of different wines at a very reasonable cost.
Well, for me, I have two that I would recommend. So, as a wine drinker, two of my favorites are in the Sacramento area. One, I think I've discussed before, is Helwig Winery in Amador County in the foothills. And I love, especially this time of year in the summer and fall, having their sparkling rosé. So, I would highly recommend that from there. This other winery is here in the area in Winters, and I was just turned on to it recently, and it's quite good. And it's called Berryessa Gap, and they have a terrific Barbera that I just enjoyed. So I would highly recommend that as well.
I'm going to throw in my two cents here because I feel like a proud mama of this book too. So my favorite wine these days, and I just came to it last July when it was my birthday, and I got a bottle of this. It's called Patrimony by Paso Robles. It's by the Dow Vineyard from the Adelaide district. It's a beautiful cab, and I'm really enjoying it these days and would like more bottles. So thanks so much, everyone, for listening, and please go out and buy the book. It's going to be terrific. Thank you. If you like this episode, please tell your friends and subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. And when you're on these platforms, don't forget to give us a big 5 stars. If you don't subscribe to any of these, you can still listen on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/PacificResearch1. That's the number one. Thanks for listening. I'm Rowena Itchon. Hope you'll come back again for next round with PRI.